Good evening. My name is Louis Calvelli, and I am the Executive Director of Casa Belvedere. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome everyone here today. And also, it gives me a great pleasure to start this series the opportunity for us to kind of get to know firsthand the authors, Italian-American authors, and share a little bit their work and the experience of what it's like to write a novel or a play and get it published. Today we have the pleasure of having with us Richard Vettieri. Richard is a playwright. I know that for a fact because I saw his play yesterday at the 45 Bleecker, that's it. And it was a wonderful play. He's a novelist. He's a published poet. Today we're going to have the opportunity to listen to some excerpts from his book, Baroque. And Baroque is the true story of the young painter Mario Minetti and several others who lived and, of course, loved in Rome at the turn of the century in 1600. Have to write that, love. They came to Rome to find what else? Fame and fortune. And what they all have in common is the fact that they were painted by the great Caravaggio. We at Casa Belvedere are really happy to have Richard here. And without further ado, Richard Vettieri.
Essentially what happens, and I'm giving you a capsule version of the novel, is Fellini falls in love with Ranuccio Tomasini, and Caravaggio killed him in a brawl. So Caravaggio made her famous, and then killed the man she loved. Because he killed Ranuccio, the Pope put a death penalty on his head. It was called Vanni Capitale. So anyone who came across Caravaggio in Rome or anywhere in Italy could kill him. And until he was pardoned, he had to stay out of Rome. He never got back. He died outside of Naples in 1610. And just to give you an idea of dates, Shakespeare died in 1618. So the ladies are going to read sections of the novel with the characters, and I'm trying to capsulize the characters. The other one was Pietro Aldobrandini, who was the cardinal whose uncle was Pope Clement VII. And he was very important because Caravaggio painted him too. And he was the one who banned all sexual images in all Italian art. And the Romans thought that was pretty silly. So they tried to get rid of him. So there was a big battle between the Borghese's and the Francese's. And this is Rome in 1600s. And I said, how could you not write about this time period? It's just like the Wild West with a lot of culture. And I'm not sure if I actually want to read, but I'll just read the opening and then the ending. And the ladies could, they'll come up, introduce themselves, and then they're going to read a section and explain where we are, maybe. So Mario, like all young artists of the time, wants to go to Rome to become the next Michelangelo. I mean, this is pretty much what they were doing. Caravaggio's real name was not Caravaggio. That was the name of his town. If you see a map, it's a little south of Florence. His real name was Michelangelo de Merisi, and his mother named him Michelangelo, so he would become famous like Michelangelo. Interestingly enough, he hated Michelangelo's work. And a couple of months ago, right before my trip to Rome, the New York Times stated that Caravaggio has surpassed in popularity and relevance Michelangelo. So it took him 400 years after his death to get what he wanted. Yeah, no, it's kind of weird, like, Mario Minetti goes to Rome, and in those days, everybody's dream was, if you were an artist, to wake up next to the Tiber River, that you've made it. Because Rome was hard to get in. There were refugees from the plague, there were wars going on all the time. So artists were going there with no money, nothing, to try to become famous. And Mario Minetti wakes up along the Tiber, and I'm going to read the opening of the novel. The sea was like a living, breathing force, stretching outwardly from the thin, aqua-colored liquid that caressed the sandy white shoreline to the translucent royal blue heart of its pulsating magic. He stood on the beach, bathed in the glory of the blazing sun, dazzling bits and pieces of sunlight, lit ringlets on his hair as if tiny golden angels were dancing between his curls. Though he was alone, he knew all the great masters were sitting up in the grandeur of heaven with their eyes on him. Michelangelo, Da Vinci, Titian, Raphael were in awe. They knew what he was and how Rome itself should thank God and the holy saints that he had the courage, the talent, and the ambition to travel dangerous miles to claim his right. He held a brush as if it were Michael the Archangel's sword. He designed a canvas with enough passion to launch a crusade that could burn the heretic Martin Luther to cinders with nothing more than the fire of its own fury. As he saw it, he was the savior who would rid the eternal city of all its pretenders to the throne. History would memorize his name. Museums would hang his work for ages to come. He would bear the burden of this destiny with ease. As he held the entire grandeur of the remaining years of the Renaissance in his capable hands, learned men would praise him, women would desire him, and other painters announce his greatness. That was the way of his world, and he was ready to embrace it all. It was his birthright. He'd create a new art. He was Mario Manetti. So now I'm going to introduce...
I'm Laurel Fulcher, and I'm an actress and teacher, and I'm actually born and raised here in Staten Island. In the following months, Felidi and her cousin Anna spent more time on the streets of the Artaccio during the evenings and taking walks through the artist's quarter during the daytime hours. Felidi especially enjoyed spending afternoons with her newfound brother Mario, her cousin Anna, and Longhi. Felidi absorbed everything Mario and Longhi explained to her about the art being sold in the marketplace, as well as taking them to private studios where she could watch painters do their work creating magic in front of her very eyes. Anna, on the other hand, would spend all this time with her arms locked around Longhi's, telling him how she wanted to marry and have children. Anna irritated Felidi. Felidi was beginning to find her cousin's obsession with Longhi a painful distraction from her own pursuit of the good life in Rome.
My name is Meredith Napolitano, and I'm from New Jersey originally, not too far, and I'm an actress in New York. Not aware if it were day or night, Felidi heard masculine voices shouting and they woke her up. She opened her eyes, looked through the bars of her cell, and saw a righteous guardian angel berating the wicked Sabiri. How dare you treat Felidi Melandrini like this? Do you know who you will have to answer to now? He lambasted the guards. She couldn't move without pain jetting outwardly from her ribs, but she still stretched her neck to see Renuccio Tomassoni's blonde hair and blue eyes that were, at that moment, burning with white-heated anger. He was dressed in cobalt blue from head to his brown leather boots and wore a silver necklace with Saint Christopher engraved on it. He stopped yelling at the guards, then placed his face up against the bars. My dear one, my attendants will wrap you in a blanket and take you to my villa, he said to her softly. She pursed her lips to form a smile. I am saved. Renuccio kept his word and followed Felidi to mend in his villa in a spacious room overlooking the tennis court. Felidi didn't bother counting the days.
A great opportunity for us to showcase an Italian-American artist. I am, you know, we look at sculptures, we look at paintings, and I am still in awe of someone who can take a blank page and create something with it just out of thin air. That to me is just a tremendous talent, and we appreciate the fact that you came here to share that with us. And we also want everyone here to know that there'll be plenty more opportunities for us to have other artists come in and share their work with us.